Before I get into the breakdown of the game, something's come about football, and said it on the TSN show. And if you want to see my thoughts before I, make the video or release the video, you can tune in to TSN 1200. Almost every game I've called in, given my thoughts, a lot of what I say there, I'll end up saying here anyways. You get a little bit of a sneak peek. And something's come about football. And when I go to a football game, I want to be scared because the score is too close. Because the other team scored. Not because of what happened to Jalen Acklin. And am I happy that we won? Sure. But there's a part of me that's like, I would have rather lose without seeing an injury like that. Scary. It was 20 minutes. 20 minutes of us just waiting and hoping. And when the ambulance left, we didn't know what his condition was. We got word during the game that he was conscious and had movement in all his extremities. And now I'm shooting this the day after. And we've now gotten word that he's out of the hospital. He's been negative for all scans. He's been medically cleared, which it feels like a miracle. Some things are more important than football. And it was scary to see. It was not something that anybody wanted to see. And let me be clear. This was not like a dirty hit. This wasn't a play where the BC Lions player was trying to do anything. It is the nature of the sport, but it is scary. And it shouldn't happen. And I'm hoping for a speedy recovery for Acklin, and I wish him nothing but the best. And hopefully he'll be all right, and we'll be able to see him in the red and black soon. So what is up, everybody? It is your local Ottawa fan, and I am here to talk to you about the 34-27 victory over the BC Lions. And at least it was a win, right? It was a win. It wasn't seeing something scary like that and then also losing the game. And, I mean, Acklin himself had a great game. He nearly had two touchdowns. One of them was called back for OPI. We had two touchdowns that were called back because of OPI, which I don't see often. It felt throughout the game. There were a few times where we did not like the reffing. There was... Now, as a season ticket holder, I don't get to hear what the commentators are saying. I'm actually sometimes scrolling on Reddit being like, is there a reason why they made that decision? Is it explained like on third and nine or third and 10, BC went for it and they got it. And everyone in the stadium is like, no, they're like blatantly a yard short. I think what happened is that he landed a yard short, but he wasn't actually touched while he was down. And then he got an extra yard. And again, it's things like that that, you don't see in the moment, especially, if you aren't right close to the play and you're like, oh, wait, what happened? He's short. Why did the refs just give him an extra yard? What is this? Come on. The same thing happened with the non-Rouge Ward, a rare miss for Lewis Ward. It grazed the upright. Now, I think that nobody saw it, BC player included, because he tried to return it, and we tackled him, and we're like, great, that's a Rouge at least. Like, sucks that we didn't score a field goal, but a point is a point. And it stayed 20-17. And the difference between being up by three and being up by four is huge. It's the difference between a field goal tying the game and you needing to go for the full thing. You need a touchdown. If it's third and 10 at our 30 and you're down by three, easy. You go for the field goal and tie the game. But if you're down by four and there's, say, 20 seconds left, you got to go for broke. And we didn't know. It was never announced. It was never announced in the stadium that it hit the upright. So things like that sometimes leave us a little bit confused and we're like, what's going on? There were a few times where that happened where we were like, how come this happened? And this is why, quick side tangent, I really think they need to mic up the command center so that we know why they make the decisions that they do. I honestly, like, I was mad at a lot of points in this game, especially like the drive where BC ended up scoring a late touchdown. There are a few times where I thought their drive should have ended. They should have been penalized. We shouldn't have been penalized. We got them short, things like that. And, you know, it felt at times like they were kind of hand gifted, like they were gift wrapped touchdown. And I imagine it's probably not the case. And I am a biased Red Blacks fan. So, of course, I'm going to see things in a way that would benefit the Red Blacks. If there's a play that could go either way and it involves two teams that I don't really have any skin in the game, I will just be able to objectively say a little bit better. I think this is how they would call it. I'm not sure. Whereas if it's the Red Blacks, I'd probably be like, oh, well, this should go in the Red Blacks' favor. That's the nature of being a sports fan. You're going to see the things that you want to see. You know, there are times, like there was one time where we thought we had an interception. It was blatantly incomplete. Like when I saw the review, even though the crowd was booing, I was like, yeah, but that's incomplete. Like if they called that a turnover, if they called that an interception, I would have been furious if I was a BC fan. It very obviously hit the turf before we were able to secure the ball. But when it's close, I'm gonna see things that would benefit the Red Blacks. Now, Coach Bob Dice actually made a great challenge. We had a drive that was looking like it was gonna stall out, and blatant DPI, the most obvious DPI I've seen in my life, especially with the two OPIs that were previously called, and they were a little more questionable. The fact that both of them were called OPI, we were like, okay, like that wipes two touchdowns off the boards. And you're not gonna call, like, you aren't gonna swallow your whistle. So when they didn't call that DPI, we were like, okay, like the command center better call that DPI. They did. They did. So not super mad at the reffing. Again, we did win, so it's all a little harder to be mad at that. But yeah, mic up the command center. I've said it, everyone said it, everyone and their mother said it. Mic up the command center. Let us know what you're thinking. The first quarter was rough. They drive down the field, immediately score a touchdown, 7-0. And I'm thinking, Nathan Rourke, he's back. He's back. You know, one game with Rust, and now whew, he's here. We got a good drive going, but we stall at their 17. It would have been nice to immediately respond with a touchdown. We only get a field goal. And again, Swiss cheese defense out there. Nathan Rourke's making us look like children. And they get down to our 10. Now we do get them third down, so we keep it within a score, 10-3. And the next drive, we immediately lose yards, 2nd and 18, and a 35-yard return gives them great field goal position. It early on, when it was 10-3 and they had the ball in good field goal position, and the past two drives had been going pretty well for Rourke, the first quarter ends, they're 3rd and 5, but they're clearly in field goal range. I was thinking that we might be in for a long one. And looked like it was going to be 13-3. We get the block. We get a stop. We get a rouge on us instead of the field goal, which keeps us a one score game. And like I said, this is where Rhymes was called with the OPI, whatever. Their next drive, though, it started at their own 10. And if there was ever a time to get the ball back quick, it was then. And they get a first down on the first play. Immediately, they get sacked. Immediately after that, we get a pick and we start our drive at their 34. And this time, we get the touchdown. And it was Jalen Acklin. Jalen Acklin almost had two touchdowns. Like I said, OPI. Took the other one off, but he, until he was injured, he was having a great game. Jalen Acklin scores the touchdown to keep the game close. It's 11-9. We do not get the 2 points, and this is one of the times where we were pretty upset. It looked like DPI. It looked like pretty blatant DPI. I don't blame Bob Dice for not challenging, because while it looked like DPI, I don't think it would have been overturned. It's not the play that the command center would overturn. And it's on a 2-point attempt, not, you know, a touchdown. So it just goes uncalled, whatever. It's still 11-9. We get them. It's a 2nd and 9. And then the entire team misses Nathan Rourke. He goes on a huge run. We do get him out of bounds, though. We end up forcing a field goal. The defense, I gotta say, they didn't look amazing, but they did enough. They did enough. Despite that one touchdown at the start of the game, they stopped the bleeding when they had to. They allowed 2 touchdowns, but the first one, I'm going to be honest, you can kind of blame on the defense. We just, our head wasn't in the game. The second one, there were a few times where I was like, okay, you know, it was close. It was and they went for it on 3rd and long, which did surprise me, but they were in our end at about midfield. So it does make sense. But other than like I'd say the first drive of the game, that was bad. I think after that, the defense actually pretty decent, stopped the bleeding when they had to. It's 14-9, and we are moving the ball in their territory. Brown breaks a tackle, throws a pick, but they start their drive at their own 11 after a penalty, plus it was deep in their territory. Again, it sucks that we don't score on that drive, but giving them bad field position, and we start in there. We get a pick of our own deep in Lions territory. This is where it's called incomplete. So it is instead punted to us. We start at their 49. So it's a difference of maybe 25 yards, which like it would have been nice to have those 25 yards, but we still start in their territory and we fumble on the first play and give them the ball back. There were a lot of turnovers this game. There was 6 in total, 3 for both teams, which first off, I think that benefits us. Because one, we're a team that typically gives up more turnovers. And two, that's 3 turnovers from Nathan Rourke. 2 strip sacks plus a pick. We made him look very human. Drew Brown was the better quarterback this game. He threw for 390 yards. 156 more than the supposed, you know, chosen one, Nathan Rourke. If you were to tell somebody the best quarterback in the league played this game, the supposedly best. I don't think Rourke is the best after this game, by the way. But if you were to say the best in the league played, and they looked at the stat lines, 390 passing yards. And I believe, 3 passing touchdowns? I want to say, I got the stats. Let me find out. I think it was 3. Oh, maybe I don't have. And you look at the other one, no passing touchdowns. 234. 234 is fine. It's good. It's good. Who would you say is the best? Nobody's walking out of this game being like, yeah, Rourke's the best. No. Drew Brown outclassed him. And in the first half, he didn't. In the first half, Nathan Rourke, he played good. Drew Brown could have been a lot better. After our fumble, they move down the field. They score. They make it 17-9. And then our next drive, we get just enough to get into Ward's field goal range. He hits a long one. And halftime, it's 17-12. And that same theme of if you don't get us out of the game early, you're done. You're donezo. That's what ended up happening. Because the second half is when Drew Brown just went supernova. We scored 22 points in the second half compared to the 12 in the first. And they got 7. They got a touchdown. That's it. On a drive that, again, they first off, they ate up way too much time on their drive. And there were a few times where it looked like it was going to end early. Even when they did score, they scored on 3rd and goal from the 1 because we stuffed them twice. They had everything. They threw everything at that drive before it finally ended with a touchdown. First drive of the game, and we, boom, instant. Nick Martyr, the rookie, 64 yards, touchdown. Ottawa takes the lead, 18-17, and we make it the full 3-point lead thanks to Armstead, who, I'm going to be honest, didn't have a great game. I got his stats. They weren't the typical Armstead stats. He got 52 yards on 15 carries. That's not amazing, but it's enough. And I think one thing that was like a perfect example of that, we're gonna fast forward to the end of the game here. We got the ball. You know what? I'm gonna catch you up. We scored the touchdown, right? We're up 20-17. The next play from scrimmage, we recover a fumble at their 35, and then this is where the OPI wiped it off, and then we get the non-rouge. The next drive, they're looking, they take a bad penalty, and we get a stop on second and 10. And our drive after that is the one that's extended by the DPI that I previously mentioned. It was very obvious, but even still, I was like, it's obvious, but it's the command center. You never know. It would be nice to hear what they're saying. But this drive, we are able to get another touchdown. Another Mardner touchdown, the rookie with two touchdowns in a game. And now we're up 10, 27, 17. We got two objectionable misconducts on that drive, by the way. Control yourselves. Please control your team, please. But other than that, nothing too egregious. So it was just kind of weird that like we got an objectionable conduct. And then we got another one, like almost immediately after. Now, the second one was on the point after, which didn't really matter. Come on. Ward's not going to miss a field goal and miss a point after attempt in the same game. It's just not going to happen. 27 to 24, after they had their long drive that ended up, the third and one. And second and eight at our 42, third quarter ends. We lock it down in the fourth. It's the fourth quarter where the Acklin hit happens, but we did at least have a long drive here. That drive that we had, I think it took up like a majority of the fourth quarter. We scored and there was like 5-ish minutes left. So it's 27-24, and then we punch it in. Dustin Crum, third and goal from the one. By the way, we had a third and goal from the one last season. We kicked the field goal. We lost. This time we went for it. We scored. We won. Perfect example of Bob Dice growing as a coach, knowing what calls to make, making the right call, making the call that wins us the game. Because we ended up winning by seven. This ends up being the game-winning score. And a big part of that is the next drive, the Lions are moving down the field. They're chugging along. But here's the problem. It is a long, methodical, slow drive. We scored our touchdown to go up 10 with like five and change to go. So they can't have a long drive. A long drive is fine if it's a one score game, but when it's a two score game, you either need to score a touchdown here so that if you get the ball back, you only need to get a few yards, or you need to get the ball back. And they did neither. They got down to, I think, about our 12. We stopped them on third and five. If they were only down by one score, I have no doubt in my mind that Rick Campbell would have said, "Look, it's third and five. We have a chance to take the lead or to tie the game right here, right now. We might not get better an opportunity to score a touchdown." There's a good chance they could have gone for it. And with the way they were moving the ball, I do think they could have gotten it. I think there's a good chance they would have gotten it on third down. But here's the thing. When you're down 10, you need a field goal anyway. You do need a field goal and a touchdown. They kick the field goal. They make it 34-27, and they never touch the ball again. And this is where I want to give you the other play. Oh, by the way, after our touchdown, again, here's where the last two fumbles happened. We recovered the ball immediately in their end, and I thought this is the game. Like, now a field goal completely ices it. That would be like 13 points. And then we fumbled it right after. And that makes it 3-3. But with 2:07, they score a touchdown or a field goal to bring it within seven. We opt for the kick, makes sense, and we get a good return, and we start our drive. 2:01 left at our own 40. BC has a timeout. Before the season, I said that these close games are going to make a difference, and that's what we need to like focus on. Closing out games. We lose this game last year because of that. there's been so many games I'm like, oh, we would have lost this one last year. But this is like a specific example I can point out to. If we had kicked the field goal instead of going for the touchdown, we would have had a 3-point lead, not a 7-point lead. And if we had a 3-point lead, really, we would have had a 6-point lead instead of a 10-point lead. They probably would have gone for it on third down to try and take the lead then and there. Because if they kick the field goal, they're still losing. They still need to get a stopping at the ball back. They probably would have gone for it. There's a good chance they would have scored. And even if they didn't, we get the ball back, 2:01 to go. They have a timeout. They could have stopped us. We didn't let them. We made smart calls. We got multiple first downs. We forced them to burn their timeout. And with under a minute, Armstead, who, like I said, didn't have a great game, gets us a first down with under a minute. Seals the game. We kneel. Game over. We kneel. That's the game. A drive late in the game where we are up by a touchdown. 2 minutes left in the game, up by a touchdown, and they have a timeout. This is where you need that long, sustained drive. You don't need to get points. You just need to never let them see the ball again. We never did that last season, and we were given that opportunity on so many occasions where we had the lead and the ball in like 2 minutes. And we didn't do anything. And then we gave the ball back. They marched down the field. They score and they win. This season, we get the first downs. This season, we make them burn their timeout. We make them watch as the clock drips down to zero. And then we win. Because we make the smart play on third and goal at the one. Because we make the coach's challenge when it matters. Not at a 2-point conversion that ultimately doesn't really affect too much, but on a blatant DPI, a blatantly missed call that you know will get overturned. Not that you think will get overturned. Not that has a good chance of getting overturned, but one that if they don't overturn it, you gotta ask the command center what they were drinking, because you'd like some as well. This was a full and complete game against Nathan Rourke. Again, supposedly, I'm going to say it. Drew Brown is better. He is. I genuinely think he's a top 3 quarterback in the league right now. I do. And I don't think anybody can put him any lower than top 5. I think Fajardo's number 1. I think Cody Fajardo's pretty concretely still the best quarterback in the league. And then I think it's a toss-up between Vernon Adams Jr. and Drew Brown. I do think probably Vernon Adams Jr. He's been really good. And even with Nathan Rourke, and you've seen the difference. Call me crazy. If we beat the Lions next week, they got to seriously consider putting in Adams. They got to at least consider it. Because since he hasn't been playing, they've just fallen off a cliff. They started 5-1. They have a losing record now. And then I think it's Brown. And then I think he's top 3. I think some people are going to put Nathan Rourke ahead of him. Some people are going to put Chad Kelly ahead of him. Now, I've mentioned earlier, there are some things that go above football, and I don't think Chad Kelly should even be in this league. Our next home game, I will be booing louder than normal. Don't like Chad Kelly. Not a fan, not because of what he does on the football field, but because of what he does off of it. But I will get more into that in that game. But not a fan of Chad Kelly. But I think he's top 3. And our team, we had a few guys who had games. Justin Hardy, I believe, ties the record of most receptions by an Ottawa Red Black. I think it's now a 4-way tie. He had 11 receptions this game. 114 yards, 11 receptions on 12 targets. Nick Mardner, 95 yards, 2 touchdowns, including the 65-yard touchdown. Braylon Addison, 92 yards, 5 receptions on 6 targets. This year we have weapons. This year we're very good. That's completely ignoring the huge games from Pickett, Lang, Malden, an entire team effort. And after the game, Brown was talking about how we can't give up bad turnovers. He just had an exceptional game. Yeah, some of the turnovers he gave up weren't great. And he still completely outclassed Nathan Rourke. I really can't say much more about this team. Like, I've said this team's different. We're 7-2-1. We haven't lost at home. Six games in the season. We have clinched a winning record at home for the first time since 2018. We have won more games at home than we've lost. That's guaranteed. That cannot change. The worst we can do at home, the worst, is 5-3-1. Next week, we could guarantee that we finish top three in the East. If we win and the Ticats lose, that would clinch a top three East position. That would mean that every single Western team, or I guess 4 out of 5 Western teams, would need to finish with more than 8 wins to knock us out of playoff contention. I don't think we can clinch playoffs next week, but we can get really damn close. And we can basically guarantee that, you know, Hamilton's out, that Edmonton actually is on the up and up. It might end up being Saskatchewan and BC who miss the playoffs. But Calgary's at 4 wins. And they aren't looking especially strong. We're close. We are this close. Going into the season, I just wanted to make the playoffs. I want to host a playoff game. I want to win the Grey Cup. Because that's how good we've been so far. And as always, go Ottawa, go!